All right, another day, another really boring question to cover. So the thing is, I don't even think that I'm that good of a teacher, and I'm not even that passionate about these questions. But the thing is, I never found anyone that really could explain them the way I wish I was learning them, like the way I wish I could have received the learning, the way my brain is slowly creeping into these concepts. I think today's video is kind of going to be like that. Today's video is about the n-matched parens problem. This problem is really key in understanding how recursion can express our decisions and how constraints can change how our recursion happens through our recursion tree. Before I even knew what backtracking was, I tried to solve this question with like a group of friends. We like sat down, we're like, yeah, we're gonna do this. I literally sat there a half hour to an hour and I did not know what to do. And if you don't know the principles of recursion and how it adapts to this problem can be very easy or it can be very difficult. Today, we are going to make it very easy. All right, so today we have a fascinating question that really expresses the fundamentals of recursion. It is called the n-matched parentheses problem, whatever you want to call it. So our input is a number, it is n. It is the number of open brackets that we need to generate all of our parentheses, a certain amount of parentheses with n open brackets. And we're going to have n closed brackets. So if n is 1, you see we have 1 open and then 1 close. Bam, that is 1. If n is 2, then we have 2 open brackets and then this, but then there's another possibility. We have a 1 open bracket, close it. 1 open bracket, close it. And then when n is 3, then we have even more possibilities. So the possibilities scale very exponential. We have 3 opens, 3 closes. Then we do 2 opens, 1 close, 1 open, 2 closes. And then you get the picture. So this problem is very confusing. Where's the pattern? How do I understand this? How do I make sense of this? How do I even solve this under pressure? So I want to make this very clear for you, and I want you to notice the key things that matter. This is backtracking. We will be expressing a ton of decisions, and of course, whenever we have backtracking problems, the brute force will be like an exponential, complete search. We generate all these strings with n parentheses, and then we validate them, and the valid ones we keep, okay, that's brute force, we're not doing that. We're going to be using backtracking for this problem. We are going to be making decisions based on three key things, the three keys to recursion that I magically invented someday. We have our choice, our constraints, and our goal. So let's look at the three keys to backtracking, how they influence our recursion, and how they influence how we craft our functions. If you have not seen the countless other backtracking videos I've made, these are the three keys to backtracking that we must keep in mind solving these problems. This makes it very simple. It takes a complex problem with a wide decision space and narrows it down to the choices that we make at each stack frame of our recursion. Every stack frame has a state, and that state dictates how we act. So our choice is going to be at each stage, do I open a bracket or do I close a bracket? Our constraints, I cannot open more brackets than the brackets I'm given. If n is 3, I cannot have 4 open brackets. At maximum, I can have 3 open brackets. I can have 1 open, 1 open, 1 open, and then close, close, close. That is the maximum open brackets I can have. The constraint on my right bracket is going to be, I cannot close a bracket that has not been opened. If I have 0 left brackets, I cannot suddenly just put a right bracket. I can't have a right bracket as my first bracket. That will have an unbalanced parenthesis string. The key is our constraints. We can't place more lefts than n, and we cannot place a right bracket unless we have a left bracket for that right bracket to balance. Our goal is to place n times 2 characters. N is going to be how many opening brackets we can have. N times 2, if n is 3, then the length of my final strings are going to be length 6. So if I have 3 open lefts, then I'm inevitably going to have 3 closing rights. So n times 2 is our goal. Once we have done n times 2 placements, we are finished. We print or add that string to our array,
and then we recurse. We allow our callers to express more of their state and create more possibilities. That is the key to this problem. Now let's do a walkthrough, keeping in mind these constraints and see how simple it becomes when we keep these constraints in mind through our recursion. So now I start my recursion. The state of the top level frame is I have three open brackets I can place, and I have three closed brackets I can place. From the first position, can I place a left bracket? Yes, I can. Can I place a closing bracket? No, I cannot, because I have not opened any brackets. If I had placed a left bracket, this amount of open brackets would be less than the amount of right brackets that I have left to place. So now we place a left bracket. So we have lost one left bracket that we have to place. We had three to place, now we have two left. And what our string looks like now is this. All right, and now from here, can I do an open bracket? Yes, I can. I have open brackets to use. Can I do a closing bracket? Yes, I can. The amount of left brackets are less than the amount of right brackets left to use. There is a left bracket I can close. I have that choice. I can make two good choices here. Open a bracket or close. Let's make both of them. And again, this is not how the recursion would proceed. It'd go in a depth first manner. We're just doing this for example's sake. And so now, do you see? We used a left bracket. We are down here. We have one less left bracket to use, but we still have three right brackets left to use. And now we have not used a left bracket, we still have two, but we just used a right bracket. We closed, and guess what? From this positionality, there's no way we can use a right bracket. Why? We've already closed our left bracket, do you see? The left is not less than the right brackets I've left. So we know that's gonna happen there. So let's continue on from these positions. So can I open a left bracket? Yes, I can. I have left brackets left. Can I open up a right bracket? Of course I can. I have less left brackets than right brackets, less brackets left to be exact, and I'm able to put a closing bracket. So let's express both decisions. And now, notice, this is our new positionality. Again, we're going breadth first like this. This is not how recursion would do it. It would go depth first. But anyway, so we use the left bracket. One, we subtract one from one. Now we have no left brackets to use. All we can use is right brackets. That's fine. We have three left brackets to close. The way we get the amount of brackets to close, we do right brackets that we have left minus left brackets. So there's three left brackets to close here. That's fine. We can place right brackets there. So here we see our left bracket amount stayed the same, but notice that our right bracket amount reduced. We've made a closing. From this position, can I place a left bracket? Yes, I can. There's a one right there. Can I place a right bracket? Yes, I can. There are left brackets to close. 2 minus 1 is 1. There's one open bracket here that I can close, and we notice that is true. So here, can I place a left? Of course, there's a one right there. I still can do that from this state in my recursion. Can I place a right bracket? Yes, I can. There's one less than two. So now, from this position, I can express more things. So let's express even more possibilities. And do you see now, as we're getting lower and lower in this recursive tree, we are approaching the answer. We are approaching the output that we desire. Again, code will not do it breadth first like this. It's going to do it depth first, but you can see how these are the base cases that craft our answers. And from here, these positionalities, we can make another step. Here, what can we do? We see zero. We cannot place a left, but we can place a right because the amount of lefts we have left to use is less than the amount of rights we have left to use. Therefore, there are two lefts that we need to close. From this position, we're gonna close a right, and then from that position, we're gonna close a right. From this position, what can I do? I can open a left, but I cannot open a right. Why? There are zero left brackets unbalanced at this position. I cannot do that. I cannot place a right. From here, I cannot place a left. I have zero lefts left to place. I can place a right though, and from there I will place another right because I have zero lefts left to place from this position, but I have two rights left to place, and the rights will just close everything off. From here, what can I do? I can place one left, that is fine. I have a left to place, but I cannot place a right. Why? The reason is there's no lefts left to close. We need to open a bracket before we can close. So from this position, there's going to be one opening bracket, but we cannot do a closing bracket. So this is the intuition. This is the understanding I want you to understand. I want you to know from every position we have a state, and every one of those states dictates how we continue in our recursion. It will dictate how we approach our answer. If we finish this tree off, we would have our answers. That's how the code would be. By the way, the code is in the description for this problem. But this is the intuition behind this problem. We want to know how many opens we have left to use, how many closes, and how do those constrain each other. So that is the key to this problem. All right, so for our time and space complexities for this problem, n is our input. It is the amount of left brackets we can open, or it's the amount of n match parentheses. So if n is 3, our strings are going to be length of 6, because for every left that we open, we need a right to close it. So then we would have 3 times 2, we'd have 6 as a length if n is 3. So for the time complexity is actually pretty involved. In an interview, you would definitely not have to deduce the time complexity exactly, but I'll leave that up to you because I would probably explain that wrong. For the space complexity, so if n is 3, at maximum, our call stack is going to go a depth of 6 because we are going to need to make 6 placements for the length of the string. So the length of the string is going to be 2 times n. So that yields this, and then it just becomes O of n. We're going to scale in a linear fashion as the n gets arbitrarily large. So that is how the space complexity works, and the time complexity you would probably not have to perform in the interview. If you did, that would be unfortunate because it is fairly rigorous. So that's all for this video. If this explanation was clear, subscribe to the channel and like this video. These videos are to help software engineers prepare for the interview. I want this channel to become the best channel for software engineering videos and to teach these subjects as clear as possible so that people can understand them easily. So that is